reminiscence is requested, wrote little Johnny White. But with this invitation, there is a stipulation.
Paisley Patter is funded by the Heritage Lottery Fund. It's a national initiative, and the idea is to gather stories from all over Scotland, communities all over Scotland, to collect them in a national archive of stories and memories. And our remit is to gather stories from people who grew up in the 1930s in Paisley, so Paisley between the wars.
Patrick O'Donnell was born in Johnson, 34 Lakehart Side Street, Johnson, and I've been over well many years in doing Paisley. We got married when I was 28, and I've been living in Paisley ever since that, which is well over 40 years.
Jean O'Donnell, and I was born in New Street in Paisley 85 years ago. There was quite a few shops in it that they have all gone away now. There's nothing there like that now. The community life was all the neighbours looked after one another. If you wanted something, you could go to your neighbour's door and ask them, and they would do it for you.
I was born in Blackhall Street, just opposite. Well, it was about 5 minutes from the mill. So it was quite handy when I did start. Well, I didn't start work there. We moved to Shortridge Road then, in a bigger house. We were in a room and kitchen in Blackhall Street. And I was the sixth child, so we had to move. Well, we got a two-room and kitchen. They made the other wee house into the one house.
I lived in New Street till I was married, and just a kitchen, no toilet or anything like that. We had to go down the stairs, even in the middle of the night, to go to the toilet. We had to take our time. There were no toilet paper. We had to go and get a paper. When my father brought in papers, it was cut up, put into wee squares, a string put through it, and that was your toilet paper. We were three up, and they had quite a number. It was like six flights of stairs to go down to go to the back door to get your washing in, and we had another big flight of stairs to go up. This day I had left out my washing, and the chap next door chapped the door, and he said, "I'm running down, there was somebody up pinching my underwear." And he ran down New Street after him, but unfortunately he didn't catch him.
I used to go to the dancing and all the Templars. I might probably need the Miss McBride there, a wee dancing on again, I don't know. I used to go to the Templars, the big co, and Burns. We used to go to the oil dancing, so I did. I was in the Navy during the war, you know, at 16. We used to go to Burns, done the dancing there. So in Burns, I met Jean there. So we started going with each other, you know. And Jean worked in Queen Street Station, up in Glasgow. Queen Street, a warehouse, wasn't it, Jean? And she used to stand at the whistle every day. The time I was going along in my bus, she used to go in my bus, crazy. So that was as I know. That was many years, 59 years ago. 59 years ago. Never had an argument or nothing.
Going out in the night out, we used to just go to the dancing. There was no nightclubs or anything like that. There was about four or five dance halls in Paisley. And that was what we done. Or if you didn't go there, you went to the pictures. Which there again, there were about five or six picture halls in Paisley. And on a Saturday or a Sunday was the highlight of our week. We walked from Paisley High Street out to Varshaw Park and come back again dressed in our best clothes. We just walked, and then we went in for a coffee and we had a hot orange. We met people. I'm not saying which sex they were. The student had a wee blether with them, and then you just walked on. That was what we done. Other than that, we were very quiet.
I was in the Rosebuds, which was part of the Girls Life Brigade to start off with, Brownies. And then I went into the Girls Life Brigade and I became an officer in the Girls Life Brigade. And I went to London to dance in Albert Hall. And I used to teach the boys' brigades. I used to teach the boys, the young boys, the country dancing and the knot tying.
In front of our big tenement was it used to be a foundry. My father worked here, God rest him, it was a foundry. Then it made it into a big football ground. And we used to always play football there. We were all young and that, played at football and that. And we used to have a wee ball, a tannery ball, a small ball, kicking it about. So they lost the ball, and the ball got kicked over a building and they couldn't get the ball. The ball was away, you know, and that was us, had it, and they ball. So this wee mate of mine, wee Peter Maguire, he went to America, immigrated. He says, Paddy, he says, have a good idea. He says, you got a bit of paper and a pencil? I says, what are you going to do, Peter? He's a pencil and paper. So I says, well, here a wee bit of paper, here a pencil. You know what he wrote in the paper? Three sell per little football team, for it is very small. And every penny you put in will help to buy the ball. Jeez, what are you doing with that? Just go in the door. Chop the door. You ruin the door and that. He'd have bought about half a dozen, boy. Everybody would need a penny, tuppence and that. Get the ball, you know. I'll never forget that.
The other thing that was happening in the 1930s was there was a great sense of moving towards an industrial future, because there were industries growing up all over Paisley, buildings growing up, the Cadbury's factory and Brown and Polson's and the tannery and of course the mills.
I'm chairman of the old Paisley Society at Smushock Cottages. Over a period of 30 years we realised that people, when they saw the mills closing, they were bringing things to us, connected with the mills. Now, we're to do with weaving, but we didn't want to throw it away, but we knew there was a great feeling that people wanted to hear about the mills and keep the history of the mills going, because it made Paisley the successful rich town that it was. It was the mills that did that. This is the 10th anniversary of this building being used for a mill museum, but really we've been talking about it for about 15 years, and it was Marcus Dean that got us the place, and to have it in a thread mill anywhere else, it wouldn't have been the same anywhere else. If you'd got an old building, an old warehouse, it would never have been the same, because you've got the people that come in here that have their memories. We have got thousands of photographs and newspapers about women that have worked in the mill over the years.
My mother worked in the mill. Actually, when I started in the mill, I was working with women. My mother worked with me. So when you went to the mill, you were 16, 17, you know. You worked with women all ages. They were retiring when you were starting. I mean, I have friends that 40 years, 50 years, that I still keep in touch with, that worked in the mills.
We were in transport and everything here. The mills had that, the mills had everything here. Three fire engines and everything. Now that's what the houses say you're going to do to the place. The houses that I'm doing there, that was the firemen's houses. And they could only go to a certain level in Paisley. They couldn't go to Paisley Cross at any time. And the pub they could go to was a lighthouse. And that was a no anymore. You can't get any further than that.
The Second World War legacy was the National Health Service. Prior to the National Health Service, there was no health care provision, and Paisley, of course, was no stranger to that. And Lady Agnes Russell, who was a benefactor of the town, saw the plight of the women and children in Paisley, and her legacy was the beautiful Russell Institute, which she dedicated to the people of Paisley, particularly the women and children, for the benefit of their health and their well-being.
I think that the Russell Institute was the main place for children to get their teeth done. We didn't have all the dentists that are in the town now, and it was all my brothers and sisters went there as well. And then we used to go and get, you used to get your baby food at the Russell Institute as well. So when my kids were born, that was where you had to go to get the big tins of milk.
I think it's a tragedy. I really do feel it's a tragedy that that building's not being used and benefiting the community and doing what they can to restore it or upgrade it and make use of it. It's an ideal place in the centre of the town. I'm very pleased with what they've done in the town hall, and look at the difference that's made. I think it's wonderful, but I wish they could do it for the Russell Institute. I just think it's necessary.
I remember thinking, a beautiful building. It was years since I had been in it. It was Princess Mary and her husband that opened it, and she remembered them coming down New Street in their carriage to open the Russell Institute. So it was obviously considered important enough for royal visitors to come and open it.
The Paisley Patter project has been designed as a reminiscence project. Young people interviewing older people about their memories. And our young folk have gone out to church groups and community centres across Paisley to gather those stories and memories. We were invited to get involved with the Great Scottish Tapestry, which is another national initiative, this time gathering a panel, an embroidered panel, from each community across Scotland, and pulling those all together into a magnificent tapestry, rivaling the Bayeux tapestry. In fact, rumour has it it's going to be actually longer than the Bayeux tapestry. So we decided that what we would do as the main output from the project would be to make an embroidered panel. The obvious partners to be involved in that would be the Paisley Threadmill Museum. I mean, who else would we have to be involved? We're using Coates' threads, we're using Paisley threads. The partners would be the Paisley Threadmill Museum. And so it has been. And a group of stitchers have gathered and have been meeting every Wednesday afternoon and Saturday afternoon for half a year now, stitching stories that they, well, first of all, sharing stories and lots of cups of tea, and turning those stories into panels for the Paisley panel in the Great Scottish Tapestry.
Now, we had no money, we had no nothing. It's the volunteers that went out and gathered the stuff and put the stuff together. We've got stuff from outer skirts, you name it. Our chairman, Mrs. Eleanor McAlpine, she's the one that's run it, encouraged people to come. And of course, this night that we're having tonight, this is a great thing for her, because this is what she wanted to see. She wanted to see it getting used for the community. And we want to see the use that people had for the mills, and that they still have this affection. Thousands and thousands and thousands of us worked over the years, and still friends, still. And as I said earlier, you don't get any older when you work in the mill. You're a mill girl to the day you die.
I'm Jack Wardrop, and I've been asked to speak about this panel that the Paisley Stitchers are making for the Great Tapestry of Scotland. This is a cinema goer. We had 8 cinemas in Paisley at one time. At 12 year old, I had a wee job with a sawdust merchant, where we went to the mills and collected bobbins and sawdust. And this chap had a rotary, riddle, whereby my job was to shovel the contents into this rotating riddle, which separated the bobbins from the sawdust. And in those days, both the fishmongers, butchers and pubs all had sawdust in their floors then. So the sawdust was used for the shops, and the bobbins was used for kindling. Art Deco is featured in both the top and the bottom. And in many of Paisley's fine buildings, you can find Art Deco, mostly in staircases, but it was very popular in the cinemas too, Art Deco. Now, window hanging was a favourite thing. It was like a neighbourhood watch, and they concentrated in what the kids were all playing in the back door. They were playing games, kick the can, relievers, hide and seek, hunch curry hunch, and jumping on and off dates. So it was a happy time, really. Actually, the whole panel represents a part of my life.
One of the highlights of the project has been the Preston Pans, world famous Battle of Preston Pans tapestry coming to the atrium of the finishing mill in the Anchor Mill complex. We had the tapestry on display for a week. We had hundreds of visitors, and it acted as an inspiration for our Paisley panel stitchers. They were able to see the potential results of what they were doing. They were able to find new stitches to try out. And the fact that the tapestry was in that amazing space in the atrium filled the space and filled us with ideas of how that space could be used by the community in the future. It's our dearest hope that the Paisley Patter project will continue beyond the end of this first phase. The partnership with the Threadmill Museum has been wonderfully rich on both sides. I know the Threadmill Museum folks have felt that having the stitchers in each week, demonstrating using threads, has been a huge advantage. And the Great Scottish Tapestry people are now moving on to do the Diaspora Tapestry, and they've invited the Paisley Patter group to get involved in no fewer than three panels for the Great Scottish Tapestry, which will depict some of the other countries that were involved with mill and threads and the Paisley shawl. What's very essential now is that we find a new generation of champions of Paisley's heritage. Two of the main players in that, who have been interviewed for this film, were Ellen Farmer, who was the chair of the Smallshop Cottages and Paisley History Society, and Eleanor McAlpin, who was the chair of the Paisley Threadmill Museum. Sadly, during this project, both of those wonderful ladies have passed on, leaving a huge gap to be filled and for Paisley's heritage to be taken forward into the future. The Paisley Patter project was very dear to the hearts of both Ellen and Eleanor. It's a great sadness that they didn't live to see it to completion. But we hope that this film and the archive footage and memories that we've gathered, as well as the embroidered panel, are a fitting legacy to their memory. What a very, very wonderful day for you and me, dear. Church bells will chime. You will be mine when
Just fine. And I said,